All right, so what we're going to look at here is decomposing and expressing coplanar forces. So the idea of coplanar forces is that we're working in 2D, which is kind of nice. Now there's two ways that you'll see a lot of having a vector written. You'll usually either see a vector written like this with an angle and, you know, some magnitude, or you'll see a vector drawn like this. Where maybe you're given a general magnitude, but then instead of giving you the angle, it's going to say something like, you know, 3, 4, 5, or A, B, C. It's going to give you some kind of Pythagorean triple that you can manipulate to figure out what that force actually is. So we'll look at both of these examples here. So let's focus in on this one. The one I'm boxed in. So what's important is that you don't memorize formulas. And some teachers may say, it's really important. I'm not thinking it's really that important to memorize it. It's just more important to actually understand it. Okay? So if you have a problem, having a basic issue with managing my space. If you have a problem that looks like this one up top on the left, if I want to decompose it into its x and y components, I can do this using trigonometry, right? Let's delete that for a sec. So if I call this, I'm not going to call it x and y because I don't want you to get caught up in which one's x and which one's y at this point. So I'm going to call this, say, p and q. Okay? So if I use trigonometry, I know that sine of theta is going to be... that the sine of theta is going to be opposite over adjacent, so q over the magnitude of f. So q is going to equal f sine q, right? And I know that the cosine of theta is equal to the adjacent over the hypotenuse, so p is going to be f cosine theta. All well and good, right? Okay, now, what I can do, and this is really bothering me, I'm just going to go ahead and delete it. What I can do is sometimes I can have another way of seeing this. Well, what happens if the theta is up here? Right? Okay, and the reason that this is important, the reason I'm going over this is I just want you to know that whenever you're doing engineering, you can't just plug and chug. I'm a mathematician and I love math, but at some point, you know, I got really frustrated with my physics and engineering classes at some point because I was just like, but I just want the formula, and engineering doesn't work like that. It's really frustrating. And so this is what I'm trying to show you here. So I'm going to draw my triangle this direction because it makes more sense because that's the angle that I know. And sure, I can do this whole thing with a 90 minus theta, but I'm not going to because that would be really, really annoying. And I'm going to call these sides S and T. So I know that the sine of theta is going to be the opposite over the hypotenuse. So T is F sine theta. And I know that cosine theta is adjacent over hypotenuse. So S is going to be F cosine theta. Okay. Now, the reason we did both of these examples is it really depends on where the theta is. In this case, Q is the Y component. Right? Y component. In this case, P is the X component. So you might say, well, of course, it's the Y component because it goes with sine. But yeah, maybe, except over in this example, T is the X component, and S is the Y component. All right? So don't go memorize, say, well, the X is always this one and the Y is always this one. Remember it more in terms of opposite and adjacent. So in this case, or in all cases, sine is the opposite of the angle. Sine is the opposite of the angle. Don't worry about whether it's x or y. It's the one that's opposite. Cosine is the one that's adjacent. So sometimes it'll be the x, and sometimes it'll be the y, but it'll always be the one that's adjacent, okay? So again, don't just memorize things. Figure them out in a way that makes sense. All right, now we'll go back to the other one that I erased, which is if you've got a function, or a vector, something like this, and it's related to a smaller triangle, say ABC. And really what they're doing here is they're showing you ratios. Now you might see books that'll say, okay, well, the f of x component is fa over c or something. Don't memorize that. You've only got a finite amount of memorizing space, and don't waste it on something like that, okay? What you need to recognize is that there are two components to this vector, and they are related to that mini triangle. So think about it as a ratio. Think big triangle to little triangle is big triangle to little triangle. So F is to C, I'll label these X and Y. F is to C as Y is to B. Do you see that? Big triangle is to little triangle as big triangle is to little triangle. I didn't mean to say that, just the magnitude. And F is to C as X is to A. Okay? And work it out from there. Just don't worry about memorizing the way things go, just figure them out, because every single problem is going to be different in some way. Okay? So again, to make sure you understand what's going on, these are my big values. These are my big triangle values. And I'm relating them to my little triangle values. Okay? And generally, whenever you're working problems, especially out of a textbook, they're going to give you relatively easy things to go. So they'll say, okay, well, this length is 12. Well, not 12. Let's say this length is 20. And they'll say that this is a 3-4-5 triangle. It's not drawn to scale, clearly. I guess I could flip those so it would actually look right. Call that a 3-4-5 triangle. So now you could formally go through here and you can say, okay, 20 is to 5 as, I'll write these in here again. 20 is to 5 as y is to 3. And you could work that out. And then you could say 20 is to 5 as x is to 4. And you could work that out. But again, don't work harder than you have to. Most people will just look at this and they'll say, oh, to get from 5 to 20, I need to go times 4. So that means I need to multiply all these by 4 as well. So that means that y is 12 and x is 16. And that's what you would get by working out those equations above as well. Okay? So again, don't think harder than you have to. Now finally, rather than, you know, saying x is this and y is this, remember that we can express vectors using ij notation. So I hat is the unit vector in the x direction, and j hat is the unit vector in the y direction. So this particular vector that we have up here, rather than saying x is this and y is this, I could say it's going to be 16 I hat, so 16 in the positive x direction, and then 12 in the positive j direction, so I hat and j hat. And if you wanted to know the direction, so if I want to know the direction, I can just remember that my tangent of theta is opposite over adjacent, right, or y over x. So I could say that theta is going to be equal to the inverse tan of 12 over 16. And if I really wanted the magnitude, that it's the square root of the sum of the squares, because it's the Pythagorean theorem. Okay, pretty good. Now we particularly like doing things in xy notation, because when we have, say, a bunch of vectors that are all added together, it's really just as simple as adding their x and y components. So say I had a bunch of vectors that look like this. Rather than having to go and add them foot to tail, if I know how to write them in ij notation, so if I know that f1 is equal to, say, 3i hat plus 2j hat, and if I knew that f2, well, we'll call that one 2i hat minus 4j hat, and we'll call f3 minus 5i hat plus 3j hat. And if I wanted to know the resultant of all those vectors, I literally just add them. So 3 and 2 minus 5 is 0i hat plus 1j hat. And again, I could find the direction and the magnitude just by using the tangent and the square root of squares. So it's all kinds of exciting.